So these patients were then evaluated by a neurologic score called UPDRS, or the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale. It rates their bradykinesia, it rates their stiffness, et cetera. And you can see both groups started out the same. Higher scores are worse. The resistance training group got progressively better during the trial. That's amazing. I mean, they didn't even just flatten out, they actually got better. That curve started to go back up. The other exercise group got maybe slightly better, but at the end of 24 months, they were in the same place they were in the beginning.
Hi. で、こちらがですね、UPDRS スコアというものを用いてですね、動き、パーキンソンの方のその、動きの制約ですとかですね、筋肉の硬さ等を測っていくんですけれども、同じスコアでその両方のグループがスタートして、その後筋トレ群がですね、とても良くなっているんですね。ご覧の通り、フラットではなくってベターになっている、改善しているということで、エアロビ群は少し良くなったものの、24ヶ月ですか、経過してした結果、結局同じところへ振り出しへ戻っているという、そういう結果になっています。
So this is a very significant effect in a small studyyou know what a p-value is, the lower the better. And a p-value of 0.001 means there's a 0.1% chance that the data was just a statistical anomaly. So that's considered to be a fact. These patients do get better. I think this trial could be improved in many ways. I think Parkinson's patients are weak. I think if you gave them a faster, more effective way to get that exercise, like we've seen from Jim's work, that you could get much more effective exercise, and you could even improve these patients more.
はい、でこちら小規模の治験でしたけれども、有意差が出ました。その統計パワーで 0.001 ということですので、これは有意差とみなされます。でこれを見て改善の余地はあるもののですね、その私が思ったのは、その患者さん、とてもパーキンソン病の患者さんというのは体力がないですから、短期間で効果的にですね、何かトレーニングができればと、そういうものが理想なのではないかと感じました。
But there's another thing that I want to point out that makes this even, where we could improve the results, I think, even more. And that is, gets back to this original cartoon here. Here would be the treatment. But what if you could diagnose patients earlier, before they went to the physician, before they exhibited a tremor, but when the disease process was occurring, when they were starting to lose neurons in the brain. Now, those patients could be identified by PET scanning, but of course, that's very expensive. But it turns out there's better ways to identify these patients. And this research is now going on, mostly a friend of mine named Ken Merrick in New Haven. And that's olfactory dysfunction. Turns out that, everybody loses smell as they age. But extreme loss of smell is actually a very strong predictor for onset of Parkinson's disease. And it's very difficult for the individual to actually know that they're losing their smell, because every day they just recalibrate and they think their smell is doing fine. But there are simple scratch and sniff tests, your scratch and smell, where a patient themselves can accurately score their smell or evaluate their own smell using this test, as well as a neurologist can. And patients with low olfactory ability are much more elevated, have a much elevated risk of Parkinson's. So this way, you can find patients who are at risk of getting Parkinson's later on.
で、もう一つですね、何かこう、予後を改善できるとしたら、そちらの診断後の期間を長くすることと、それから早期診断をするという方法もあると私も気づきました。ドクターに、患者さんがですね、症状が出て、私の、ドクターのところに来る前に、震えが出る前に、ニューロンがなくなる前にですね、例えばペットスキャンのような方法もあると思うんですけど、ペットスキャンは高いです。でもっと もっと良い方法がないかと考えたところ、その嗅覚障害とそのパーキンソンのその進行がですね、密につながっていることが分かりまして、皆さんその高齢化に伴ってだんだん嗅覚障害っていうのは出てくるものなんですけれども、その進行が早いとですね、パーキンソンが出やすいというのが分かっています。で例えばその嗅覚っていうのは皆さん日々何か匂ってるものですから嗅覚がなくなると気づきやすいなのでなんか簡易テストをですねスクラッチ&スメルって言ってこうちょっと引っかいてですね匂いを嗅ぐっていうそういうテストを簡易テストをしてでスコアをつけてですねでこの嗅覚スコアがそのゼロが全くなしなんですけど嗅覚スコアが低ければ低いほどその後でパーキンソンのリスクが高いというそういう相関関係を見出しました。
You are watching a multi-part presentation featuring Dr. Peter Lansbury, Professor of Neurology at Harvard Medical School. If you are watching the playlist, the next video will begin automatically. If not, visit the KAATSU Global website for more information.